This is a Proactive Investors audio interview with me, Jeremy Naylor. This interview is not to be taken as investment advice. I'm talking now to Angelos Damaskos, CEO of Sector Investment Managers and fund manager of the Junior Oils Trust, about the opportunities in the African oil space. Angelos, welcome. We've heard a lot about oil opportunities for investors in Africa, particularly recently, of course. We've had ongoing interest in Cove Energy, but also smaller companies like Simba just releasing a CPR. The stock has risen on the back of the recent discovery in Kenya from Tullow Oil, but a lot of interest surrounding the likes of Simba Energy on such reports as this competent person's report that it's received. Can you give an overview of the, first of all, your fund performance and your African exposure, and commentary on what you believe to be the African oil story?
Thank you, Jeremy. First of all, interest in the East African oil space has increased greatly recently on the back of the amazing discovery by Cove Energy of huge volumes of gas offshore Mozambique. That supported the takeover of this company, which is still to be finalized. And it seems that Shell is in a pole position, but it's still not concluded. And subsequently, by the very large, the very good drilling results, as you say, by the first drill by Tullow and Africa Oil in a joint venture in Kenya, which indicates potential resources of very large size indeed. And according to words of Tullow, they are the best results they have seen in their African operations. So it is extremely promising. So there has been a lot of activity by smaller companies securing neighboring license areas and acreage that could be equally prospective. Of course, most of them argue that they are on trend with the existing discoveries and therefore very likely to find oil. Now, investors have to be very careful in backing companies, smaller companies that claim the valuation of their shares is very high because on the back of competent persons reports. Because even though the technical assessments on 2D seismic and partial 3D seismic may show very large targets indeed, it is very easy for a smaller company to drill in the wrong place and have a very disappointing result for its investors.
And then presumably run out of money.
Yes, for a small company, these wells are very expensive. They are proportionally to the size of the company's balance sheet, they could have a very, very negative impact. And that therefore make it much more difficult for the company to raise further capital and continue its operations.
So do you think we'll see more of what has happened or is happening to Cove? Do you think we'll see a lot of M&A in this area for the smaller oil companies and explorers being taken out?
There could be, but I think the seasoned operators, the likes of Tullow, etc., will wait for the first drilling results. They will wait to see what is it that they have actually found in order to make a reasonable and realistic assessment of the potential resource size before they take over a smaller company. The exploration game is always stacked against the explorer, typically in an 8-to-1 ratio. So it's much more likely there is a disappointing result than a successful one. And at the early stage of assessing 2D and 3D seismic data, is the most dangerous part because no one really knows which is the precise point to drill, and that's how the industry operates. So there will be undoubtedly further takeover activity in the area because the indications are that the resources are potentially vast, but only in companies, it will focus primarily on companies that have achieved successful well results,
right,
such as Cove, for example.
What about the political risk, especially in Kenya with the borders it has?
Yes, the political risk is one of the main reasons we have so far avoided the East African space in our fund, into junior oils, and we have only focused on very, very small selective investments that should become should the bear negative news would not adversely affect the performance of our portfolio. But having said that, there is this increasing interest by operators to drill in that space, given the very large prizes that are potentially available. Now, of course, Kenya borders with Somalia. We all know about the piracy activities. We all know the instability of the region. And there is instability in the northeastern part of Kenya where they border with Somalia. But generally speaking, Kenya is a much more secure, much more stable economic environment, much more stable government, and therefore it is much more attractive in terms of investment for large operators such as Tullow and Africa Oil. And therefore, thereby, their success and their interest draws into the territory smaller companies that are at the earlier stage of the cycle.
So what about your exposure as a fund manager of the Junior Oils Trust at Sector Investment Managers? What about your exposure, your favoured stocks?
Well, we have certain small holdings in companies that operate in the territory. In Kenya in particular, we favour a company called First Australian Resources.
This is an Australian listed company,
isn't it? In Australia, mm-hmm. And it has operations not only in Kenya but also in Senegal and Guinea-Bissau, so it has a more diversified portfolio. Again, it doesn't only focus in Kenya, but in Kenya it holds license areas both onshore and offshore that, similar to Simba, border existing, operations by larger companies and potentially very highly prospective trends that could be very material to become successful. FAR is still at the seismic processing stage, so it is very, very early stages, and that's why we have allocated a very small percentage of the fund into this play. And as the seismic processing activities mature towards the end of the year, they interpret the targets, they are in a much better position to farm out. And this is the sensible strategy followed by smaller companies like FAR. So they assess the seismic data, they establish the targets, the potential size of the resource, similar to what Simba is saying. But then they go out to larger companies and present their results and say, will you farm in and pay us a certain premium for the work we have done? And therefore they get carried for no extra capital at risk for the potential for the drilling, which could be positive or negative.
I notice actually in amongst some of the London-listed stocks that you hold in the fund, Serica Energy is one of those.
Yes, Serica Energy, again, has a diversified portfolio. It has operations in the North Sea, in the Irish Seas, and as well as a very large and highly prospective acreage offshore Namibia. Now, Namibia is the part of their assets that has attracted us the most into that company, because there is another company called Chariot Oil and Gas that has been very much in the center of activity and investors' interest on the back of their interpretation of 2D and 3D seismic data offshore Namibia that potentially indicate very large resources. Now, on the back of those results, they farmed out first to Petrobras of Brazil and secondly to BP to fund the drilling operations. Now, Serica holds an adjacent block to Chariot, which is probably approximately half the size of Chariot's acreage. And again, they have managed to secure a farm in by BP earlier this year. So they are fully carried for the cost of the 2D seismic work, which is currently being undertaken, as well as for the first two drills. And on a comparative valuation basis, if you compare the market cap of Chariot, which is wholly focused in Namibia, and that of Serica that has cash, it has other assets in the North Sea, Irish Sea, and elsewhere, it is a very, very compelling undervaluation proposal.
How about Bowleven? This was in the news recently, I believe, because of a possible bid for the company.
That's right, yes. We like Bowleven. We think, again, it holds very material and highly prospective license areas further north, offshore Guinea. I have to admit that we have traded in and out of Bowleven over the last 3 or 4 years. Because that's the way we operate, is that we try to acquire companies where we believe that the market capitalization significantly undervalued their assets. And Bowleven at times exceeded our target range and therefore was a candidate for cutting back or eliminating from the portfolio. But we recently, earlier in the year, have bought back into Bowleven after the very sharp sale, if you like, of de-rating in terms of market capitalization in the markets. So at roughly where it is now, to about a pound, we think it is a very, very cheap entry into the license areas, which are at a much more advanced stage than the other two I've mentioned earlier. They have had some successful drilling results. They have a much better idea of the size of the prospective resources and reserves, and therefore they are in a much better position to market their company and their assets to potential suitors. Now, there has been an approach recently. They never disclosed who the suitor was, but it seems that it failed to materialize. They probably failed to agree on a price. And therefore, with this potential bid being removed from the table, investors seem to have lost interest again, and the shares have slid back to the current levels. But we think at these levels, they are extremely cheap and offer a great option for a very large and highly prospective basin.
I'd just like you to comment on one other facet of all of this. Underlying all this is the price of oil. What are your thoughts as the price of Brent goes below $100 a barrel?
Yes, we believe that we have long maintained that it is unlikely for Brent crude price to fall significantly below $100 a barrel. And we have to bear in mind that Brent is the yardstick or the benchmark for pricing West and East African oil as well as Middle Eastern oil. So really it's the most representative price of crude oil for the European, North African and African territory. And therefore, on the basis of the statements made by Saudi Arabia, principally, which is the most important member of OPEC, we believe that the OPEC members need oil to remain at around $100 per barrel to fund their social programs. Saudi Arabia is extremely concerned by the militancy and activity, rebellious activity in North Africa and other countries in the Middle East, such as Syria and Iran. And they have embarked on a very dynamic and very large social program to keep their population happy, basically. And they have said, they have maintained that they need oil to stay at around $100 a barrel to fund this program. So it's unlikely they will let it slip far below that price level without cutting back production.
Thanks, Angelos, for that. Angelos Damaskos there from Sector Investment Managers. This interview is not to be taken as investment advice.